Ah, see? The entire High Plains. This is my kingdom, as far as the eye can see.
Welcome back. I'm Michael, by the way. YouTube was gracious enough to come all the way down here and tape this. So thank you, YouTube. Some of you may remember that I said 2020 might be particularly good for storm chasing. And I have to apologize. That just didn't happen. We are all just shocked. Everything looked like it would be a banner year, just like 1990. This is the worst.
It's true. All signs pointed to 2020 being a 1990-like year. There were so many similarities over the winter, and spring of 2020 actually did play out much like 1990. Each year, at the opening of these videos, I like to mention that this is a fun and academic exercise, and don't let me fool you here. I'm not trying to make last year's bad forecast look like I was still right. Tornado prediction is the goal, and sometimes this is going to be wrong, sometimes very wrong. Predicting climate patterns months ahead of time that may lead to more or less tornado activity in a given region is almost impossible. However, the types of patterns that can lead to more supercell thunderstorms, the kind that can sometimes produce tornadoes, isn't as hard. As with 2020, there were in fact lots of storm chasing days with beautiful results. There were more setups for me to storm chase in 2020 than average, yet most of these systems did not lead to that final result. Meanwhile, the southern US way overperformed expectations.
But on to 2021. Onwards and upwards. Sometimes you need a fresh start, a clean slate, nature's reset, like being in a witness protection program.
Now, some of my audience might be storm chasers or people that just follow major weather events live on their screens. Others might have some anxiety or interest in who might be under the gun this year and how much. So I'll do my best to address all of that. And yeah, I'm doing a parody every year. Sorry. Not sorry.
No! God, please, no!
There are many reasons why 2020 failed from a storm chasing standpoint, but the background state and overall mode should have made for a more plain-centric year than we got. By January, 2018 appeared likely to be a low tornado year, and 2019 was to be an active one, and both predictions came true. Somehow in 2020, a few minor details managed to completely flip this forecast. For instance, not getting enough moisture collected up under the trough is less than ideal.
That's what she said.
Having a few details not quite pan out is just what happens sometimes. But hey, 2020 didn't turn out well for anything, so I guess none of us should be surprised. And it's why this forecast for 2021 could just as easily be wrong due to details we won't see unfold for months.
The storm chasing hobby, admittedly, is a male-dominated meetup to mostly watch rain. I guess that makes it a shower for guys. It's a guy shower. An hours-long shower with guys.
My two favorite things to watch over the winter are the state of the ENSO, that's El Niño or La Niña, and how much significant drought we have over the southwestern plains. La Niña, or cold ocean surface temperatures off the coast of South America, can influence how weather systems throughout winter and spring enter North America. On average, moderate or strong La Niñas mean higher tornado counts, particularly focused over the southern United States. Neutral and El Niño states, on the other hand, tend to move tornado counts lower, but also favoring more storms further west on the high plains. Excessive drought, on the other hand, especially in areas like West Texas and eastern New Mexico, can lead to a strong EML. Too hot and too dry means blue sky. 2021 does have a major drought problem, but it's also a moderately strong La Niña.
Welcome to Southwest Texas. The extreme southwestern fringes of the high plains of the United States are called the EML source region.
Now, obviously, this doesn't look like plains, but in between these mountains are level areas. Collectively, this area is hot, it's very dry, and it's at a pretty high altitude. In the early spring, temperatures begin to reach up into the 90s in this area, and mid-level winds start to drag this hot, dry air over the warm, moist plains in some severe weather setups. That elevated mixed layer, or cap, is sometimes responsible for suppressing storms from forming entirely, or can lead to leaving a lid on storms so that they can't form until later in the afternoon during peak heating. And one of those cases can lead to more violent storms and more tornadoes. On the other hand, it can keep storms from forming entirely, sometimes for months on end.
The stronger your cap or elevated mixed layer, the more storms get suppressed throughout the season.
I am totally alone right now with only my thoughts.
But if this part of the United States is especially wet during the winter or has experienced colder weather than usual, that can lead to a weak cap. But in this case, this area of the plains and the Intermountain West
are experiencing extreme and exceptional drought. That can lead to a much hotter, much drier elevated mixed layer. So, unfortunately, that might mean fewer storms for this season.
La Niñas can be a little bit unpredictable. Sometimes they can further dry this area of the plains out more, or it can lead to more storm systems that weaken this elevated mixed layer. But if I was a betting person, I'd say we're gonna have a very strong cap this year. And a very strong cap probably means a weak, severe weather season and a below average tornado season for the high plains.
Not all La Niñas are the same. A first-year Niña seems to affect severe weather a bit differently than a second-year La Niña when they happen to be back-to-back.
YouTube is the best thing ever. Anyone in the world can make a video about any subject, so you know you're getting the best possible information.
Let's look at the past years where we were dealing with this very same thing. Here are all the first-year La Niña springs that featured severe drought out west. Okay, it appears we have a problem here. Two analogs are really nothing to work with here. Besides that, 1955 and 1989 had pretty wildly different outcomes. But I can also loosely add 1965, which had some moderate drought in some key places. 1989 was quite inactive outside of an outbreak in the Carolinas and some late season action in Texas. Outside of June, which is the hardest part of the spring to make a good guess, 1989 was an inactive, below average spring for tornadoes. But not the worst either. 1989 spares the Deep South, which, as you'll see, is a good thing. 1955 featured an active April and May on the plains, but also somewhat active in the Deep South. May 1955 was the year of the famous F5 Udall tornado. But 1955 is a pretty old analog and doesn't help us much, as climate changes since 1955 make it a tough sell. 1965 is a little newer. This was an incredible tornado year with a hyperactive Midwest. For example, the Palm Sunday tornado outbreak over the Great Lakes, and a highly active May and June over the entire plains. Needless to say, a repeat of 1965 would be rather scary for just about everyone. But let's inspect the drought a little better. While indeed these areas in the Western High Plains and foothills near the Rockies are in drought, for the most part, this is longer-term drought. Recently, there have been several major snow events in Southwest Texas, for example, which is actually pretty rare. In over 100 years of records, this has only happened a few times. Because drought doesn't appear at the moment to be as big of a factor, we actually uncover quite a few more examples. 2011, 2008, 1999, 1974, 1971, join, 1955, 1965, and 1989.
Oh my God, it's happening. Everybody stay calm.
And now here's where things start to take an especially dark tone. All told, these analogs contain both super outbreaks, as well as more Oklahoma 99, Joplin and El Reno 2011, Louisiana's only F5, South Dakota's only F5. 2008 was the most active year on record, containing the Super Tuesday outbreak and a record number of tornadoes in Kansas. Bear in mind that drought in the West is not as effective to the Midwest and Deep South, so even if action on the plains is suppressed, this is all pretty bad news for the rest of the country, especially the Ohio Valley and Deep South. This is not something you like to see. If this analog set is correct so far, the ceiling for a very bad year in 2021 is as high as it goes. Let me show you why these years were so dangerous. I can blend these analog springs into an anomaly map for the spring months and see if there's some common themes. The upper level low pressure in the west, combined with the flattened high over the Gulf, are the most important and common features throughout these springs, which means a strong, more zonal flow aloft over the Deep South. A common feature among moderately strong first-year Niñas is a strong North Pacific upper-level high that sets everything else into motion. Having these conditions over and over throughout the spring probably means high twister counts, high chances for a major outbreak, and this is exactly the pattern that resulted in both super outbreaks in 1974 and 2011, as well as the Super Tuesday outbreak in 2008, and the Palm Sunday outbreak in 1965.
Webster's Dictionary defines twister as to utter a succession of short or small tremulous sounds as a bird.
I'm going to get a bit more sophisticated here and check all other teleconnections and also include other moderate Niñas that were second or third year in a row, then compare them to 2021 and find the best matches. Teleconnections are an alphabet soup of names of weather patterns that exist over certain parts of the globe. Other than the PDO, I don't give as much credit to these others unless there's some sort of unifying pattern that catches my eye. these second Niñas introduce us to 2012, 2009, 2000, 1975 and 76, 1956 and 1957. I can already tell something is up with this because this batch of other years had very different outcomes for when it came to tornadoes from that of the other batch. But most of them do contain a few big days in the Midwest and South. 1976, a third year Niña, having a spring more like the deadly batch. 2012 had an early spring plains outbreak, while 1956, like 65, had legendary days in the Midwest. When it comes to these second Niñas, while certainly far from completely quiet, storm chasing overall would be a bit more on the boring side, while tornado counts overall tended to be a bit lower and less destructive for the deep South and Midwest. And sure enough, the teleconnections for the current year Niña in winter of 2021 match better to the more deadly batch than the rest of these.
Well, 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 how the turntables.
By eyeballing these winter teleconnections, I can pick the best possible matches. 1955, 1965, 1971, and 2011. And yes, while these 4 years were quite deadly, they didn't all play out exactly the same way. With 2011, the April 27 outbreak weighs extremely heavy here. Many lives were lost, history was made, and many places in the South would never be the same. It's only been a decade, but we can't rule out something terrible happening this year. My hope is that if you live in the Ohio Valley, south to the Gulf Coast, you take any strong language regarding a tornado event from February and into the spring very seriously. And yes, February is included. Tornado season begins early in the Deep South. And while 2008, another analog, should serve as a great example of a February outbreak, another top analog, 1971, also featured a horrible tornado outbreak in Louisiana and Mississippi, also in February. 1955 was a bit of an exception when it comes to Dixie Alley tornadoes. It was much quieter in the South, but take that with a grain of salt. How tornadoes and storm damage were reported in the South were far different than even just a couple of decades later. The truth is, it could have been a bad year, and there's a chance reports slipped through the cracks. Or perhaps this is a sliver of hope that the Deep South can escape the type of tornado year 2021 appears to be teeing up. As far as planes chasing are concerned, 1955 and 1965 would have been banner years, much like 2008. All 4 years feature some sort of major tornado event or outbreak on the I-35 and I-44 corridors as well. Interstate 35 serves as an incidental western limit to above average tornado activity in La Niña years.
As a storm chaser, I'm optimistic, because every day I get a little bit more desperate.
All 4 years feature F5 tornadoes. And while I don't like using the word overdue here, certainly it feels like 2021 may feature the first EF5 in quite a while. In fact, if we make it through this year without one, it will be a new record. 2011 had many: Joplin, El Reno, Huntsville, and more. February 1971, Louisiana's worst tornado, another F5. 1955, as mentioned, had Udall, and 1965 featured a Northern Plains outbreak with South Dakota's only F5. Going 4-for-4 on F or EF5 tornadoes in these analogs should tell you 2021 probably isn't messing around. Of these four main analog years, 1965 would have been the best one for storm chasing, with 1955 a close second. 2011 and 1971 would be both more dangerous for the southern US, but also less interesting overall for storm chasing. Looking at long-range forecast tools, I can compare what models think might happen this spring to how my analogs performed. One thing is clearly showing up between all of them and the analogs: a North Pacific high on average. This coupled with a lot of western troughing and an elongated high pressure over the Gulf Coast. These are all signs of an active Dixie Alley. Side note, I've seen some musings from down south this winter, like, we haven't had this much snow since 2011.
I'm not superstitious, but I am a little stitious.
So here's my forecast for 2021. Every bit as likely to fail as my past three predictions. Going 2-for-3 so far is no reason to think I might end up 50-50 after doing this for a few years. But specifically, I'm sounding the alarm for the Deep South and Ohio Valley.
I'm just passing the message along. It's not like you'd arrest the guy for just passing drugs from one guy to another.
I'm going all in here. And if I'm wrong, that's wonderful news. I'd rather be wrong than right this time. If there was a kind of year where really terrible, horrible things can go very badly for the Deep South and the I-35 corridor from February to May, this would be that kind of year. some possible failure modes for this forecast. The high plains are about 50-50 in these Niña years, so it's just as likely to be active or inactive on the plains. The La Niña could take an early spring break, and it isn't one of the strongest Niñas we've seen in some of these analog years, and that could put us more along the lines of the weaker second Niñas that resulted in quieter seasons. In the upper right and in the description, I've linked to my tornado myth-busting video, which includes a wealth of very relevant tornado safety topics, many of which call out the deep south of the US specifically. We don't want another 2011, and we don't have to. So please, if you haven't watched it, do so. Now is a great time to brush up ahead of what could be a major year. Once again, all of this is for fun. While it's based on some truth, and there appears to be some merit to doing these, a lot of this information is just my intuition and some pattern recognition. Take it with a grain of salt. And let's all hope 2021 doesn't turn into a tornado dumpster fire. I'd much rather see them on the high plains and away from cities. So keep your fingers crossed. I will be too. Thanks for watching. Let me know what your predictions are in the comments. And as usual, I'll provide a status update with some sub-seasonal forecasting in early May. So be sure to subscribe so you can see that. In my channel, I cover my experiences with severe weather, astronomy, the outdoors, and much more. Have a look around my channel page and see if any of that interests you. Here's to a safe and fun season, and until the next one, I'll see you out there. Do I need this video to be liked? Absolutely not. I like when this video is liked. I enjoy having this video liked. It has to be liked. It's not a compulsive need for it to be liked, like my need for it to be praised.